Hello, this is David Aiken, your conversion rate optimization specialist. First of all, thank you for the opportunity to review your website for you. We'll be going through all of the critical pages from your homepage straight through your shopping cart as requested. Please don't worry about trying to keep up and take notes. As you probably notice, I have included a document of bullet points. That's meant to kind of serve as a guide, but more importantly, it's meant to act as a checklist so that you can make sure you get everything implemented. We are going to start off with your homepage and more importantly, with the hero shot of your homepage. That's the screen you're looking at right now. It's what your customers see when they either type in your web address or click on your ad without scrolling, okay? It's this screen's job, or we're gonna refer to it as a row, to help your customers quickly understand what you do, why they do it with you, and what they should do next. In this case, it's what you sell, why they should buy it from you, and what those next steps should be. Okay. There are really two ways that your visitors are going to interact with this screen or row. And it depends on how old they are, believe it or not. Older people like me, I'm nearly 50 now, tend to use the F pattern. Because we were raised reading our documents, whether it be a book, a magazine, a newspaper, we read line by line by line, okay? So we start over here. This is where we look first because that's how we were taught to read. We zoom across the top. We then come back, go down and across and down. Younger visitors, really millennials and younger, they were raised with the internet being the main source of content. So they're used to large blocks of content being delivered to them. They still start up here in the upper left-hand corner because that's how they were taught to read as well, and they still zoom across the top. But they come down at an angle and then back across the bottom, okay? The reason this is important to understand is to understand why top bar strategy is so important. A top bar is this bright colored bar at the top, and if we execute our header properly, that's the area that contains your logo and your navigation, we can make people read this content before they interact with anything else. We do that by pushing our logo over to the left-hand side. So we've got to stretch this template a little. You're very constrained. Your content is all straight down the center, and we're losing all this advertising space. Okay. This was popular back when monitors were square, the old CRT, big monster monitors. Those really aren't used anymore. We want to take advantage of the new larger format. Okay. So we're going to move our logo over here and push our navigation as far over here to the right as we can. We're going to put a bright colored top bar so that as they're taking that natural journey straight across, keeping this space negative or empty, we pull their attention up and deliver a message. Now, we don't need to worry about explaining all the reasons why free shipping is no longer an offer, because it's not something that you would ever offer on delivery. But we do want to explain what should go up here. Now, a good offer includes a reason, a compelling discount, and an expiration date. I will be giving you examples of content throughout this process, but please understand I'm not a content writer, so if you want to adjust it up, please do so. If you want to use it, you're free to. What I would say in my top bar is I would establish a first-time buyer's discount, okay? When people are shopping for items like this, whether it be flowers, balloons, anything gift-related especially, they sometimes are willing to be extravagant depending on who they're giving it to, but often are looking for a good value. So they'll shop around, right? They won't just look at your site and decide I'm buying product A. They want to know they're getting a good deal. So up in your top bar, I would say something like, and remember, I'm not a content writer, but crazy amazing balloons, comma, first time buyers save 10% through June 1st or whatever date you set it to. the date tends to validate the offer and creates urgency. So we're going to make a bright colored top bar up here. It can be your green, which would be appropriate. We're going to move our logo over here, our navigation over here to encourage that. We're going to put a sell in their mind right as they're starting. Okay. I'd like to see your header become sticky, which that's what's happening here. It doesn't need to be this tall. Their logo just happens to be really tall. It can go down to, you know, just about a visual inch. But we want it to stick with us so that as we are shopping or as we're exploring, I can always hit your navigation and get into your sales funnel. That's our goal, is how do we get them looking at products? Nothing's more important than getting them looking at our products, because it's the product that inspires them to decide to buy. Okay. On to your hero shop. All right. So we've got this wedding image, which would be completely appropriate if this was a event decorating landing page for weddings, right? Which we may consider doing. If we are on social media advertising to people who are engaged and looking to decorate, or if we're on one of the engagement websites or wedding websites, wedding planning websites advertising for New York. Gosh, I can't think of the name of a bunch of them right now. But if we're advertising there, then we'd want to send them to a page that's focused on wedding events and showing off pictures of weddings we've done and getting the couples excited to have their wedding look that way. But on our main page, on the page where we have mixed traffic going to it, we've got to have a more generic picture, because I start to feel like, oh, especially when I read your headline and your subheadline, and compare that to the image, I feel like you focus on weddings or major events only. And if I am looking to have some balloons delivered to my nephew for his birthday, I'm probably going to bounce and go to somebody else. Okay. So a more generic picture of just some beautiful balloons would be more appropriate for your hero shot image. Okay. Then we've got our content of the hero shot. Remember, this is meant to help people understand what we sell, why they buy it from us, and what they should do next. Right now, we're selling on the fact that we're the most upscale, and maybe that is the most compelling factor, but I worry about it, okay? Again, I'm going to give you content ideas. I'm not a content writer. But I'd like to see you utilize, what you have here is a headline and a subheadline. I'd like to see you utilize a super headline as well. A super headline looks like this. It's short bursts of information with a pipe in between it, okay? This is sight read, meaning people read it before they even realize they've begun reading. And it's meant to deliver factual information. So rather than adults, we're going to say amazing events, memorable graduations, special birthdays, weddings and anniversaries, and more, or whatever order is most important. If you deliver for birthdays more often than you do graduations, which most of the year is going to be true, then birthdays would be first. So put it in the order that's most appropriate. But basically what we're trying to do is, they come down and across with the F theory or back across with the Z, we're trying to tell them that we service the type of event or celebration that they are looking to have. We've then got our headline, which is supposed to be a more emotional delivery of what we do. So what I would play around with is something like NYC's most trusted balloon company, Dash, delivering everything from thoughtful gifts to decorating crazy, amazing events. Okay. We're telling them both items that we do right there in the headline. Then in the subheadline, it's meant to support our headline. So it should say something, you can count on us to deliver your gift or decorate for a special event on time, anytime, anywhere. I love on time, anytime, anywhere. I think it's great. I stole that from down below, I believe. Then we've got our call to action button, and you've got one of these, which is good. It's a contrasting color, which is appropriate. But we have a problem. What are we going to do? Are we going to have it open up a request for a quote? Or are we going to have it help them start interacting with our product lines if they're looking for an item to be delivered? Well, we want to have both happen. So we're going to have one button here that is shop delivery. Then another button right next to it that is get event quote. Okay. So I know that if I'm shopping to have balloons delivered, I click here, get event quote, I click here. This one should be the less popular item. If you sell more delivery, then we've got to serve that market first in order to keep the lights on, right? And then we push for events whenever we can. If events is the major, this is why I was asking the other night, if events is the major revenue stream, then events would be first and delivery would be second. The primary call to action or the most popular product is going to be in color. The secondary one is going to be a ghost button, which I believe it's going to be events as your secondary one because there's probably just not as many events to sell to. That's going to be a ghost button, which looks like this. It's just an outline, okay? Then when I click it, rather than zoom to the bottom of the page like your site currently does, I want it to open a sidebar. It's a lot more refined. It looks a lot nicer. Gives your site more credibility. Okay. Let's get back. The other thing you need to take some time to consider is your typography. That is the choice of font, font weight, font color, font type. It matters. Using some words cap, some not. All of this is typography, and it makes a major difference in read rate, which is what we care about at this stage more than anything else. We'll get through all that. Our goal is to get them to read and understand why they should either click one of these two buttons or scroll down. Okay. Below that, it's time to tell them who we are a bit more. Okay. So what we're going to do is utilize icons and short descriptions to deliver some more information. Now, in the online world, there's a hierarchy to how to effectively deliver content. The most read type of content is going to be what you're seeing here, an icon plus a short description. People read it automatically. The next most likely to be read content is a headline with bullet points. The least likely to be read content is paragraph text. Okay. Now you see an example of a row right here that has both, right? We've got icons and short descriptions and paragraph text. Boy, I sure wish they used this space. But this side is for humans. This is how we interact with information. This side is for search engines and a very small percentage of our visitors that will read the content. So what would I do if this was my site, Van Gogh? I would use an icon and a short description to say NYC's most trusted. One to say deliver anytime, anywhere. One to say special gifts to large events. And then 2,000 plus successful events. If that's in fact, if I'm interpreting that right, I found that somewhere. I think it was in your about row. Anyway, if you've done 2,000 plus events, that's significant. If the 2,000 plus number I saw is including deliveries, then maybe drop that one because we don't want to be misleading. Okay. So what have we accomplished? Well, they started up here. Remember, we want to move our logo over. And by the way, we are losing all kinds of advertising space here and here. This style was back when monitors were square, the old CRT big box monitors. Well, everybody has full width monitors or you know, wide monitors now. So we should utilize all this space a little better than we are. As you see how their content's kind of pulling and back and forth utilizing the imagery and the space a little more intently than we are. All right, so what have we accomplished? Well, they landed on our page from our social media. They saw who we are. As they're coming across the top, they're pulled up. They see that we do cool events and deliveries. They can get us savings by this date. So we're starting to create some urgency. Then they come down and they see our navigation points. As they either come across or down and across, they're seeing the type of events we specialize in. They're seeing that we do in our headline. They're seeing that we're the most trusted and that we handle everything from events to deliveries. They're having that information reiterated with our subheadline. And then they see where to go if I'm looking for delivery or if I'm looking for events. Then they're having, with the icon short descriptions, they're having that information reiterated. Okay. By the way, it's hard to look at how to execute with this kind of wave going in here. I recommend doing away with this wave. This was popular 10, 15 years ago, back when we first got the ability to do this. But now it's dated. And a dated website starts to create concerns with how successful you are. Okay. This is much better topography, by the way. Whoever did this did a good job, except for this font can be a little hard to read. So make sure you're keeping readability in line. All right. So we've accomplished all that in our hero shot with the goal of getting them to click on one of these two buttons or interact with our navigation to start looking at products. Because remember, that's what we want them to do. We want them to look at products and get inspired to buy one. Okay. From here, I would like you to pull up your corporate logos, which are way down here. Okay. This is called social proof. If I was doing this review for you 10, 15 years ago, I'd be telling you to take it off. It's noise. It gets in the way. It confuses. But that's because your main purchasing customer base was of an older generation. They were my age, right? Generation X and older. And we were raised in a much different world than the millennials and younger. We were raised in a world where we basically trusted marketing messaging, whether it was on TV, on the radio, in a magazine, in a newspaper. If we saw it, we believed it. It's how they were able to successfully sell x-ray glasses to so many young men back in the day. We all were walking around thinking we were going to see through walls. Call it gullible, call it naive, whatever you will. It's just the way the world was. That's in stark contrast to the world the millennials and younger have grown up in. To them, marketing messaging is at best an exaggeration, at worst a downright lie. They have all had or heard of the experience of somebody getting in a situation like buying an ice maker online for $200 and receiving 3 ice cube trays and a bottle of water. They just don't trust it. So they look for third-party verification that what you're saying is true or your product is valuable or what today we call social proof. Okay. Forms of social proof for a business like yours, recognizable logos, 5-star ratings, testimonials and reviews, and social media interaction. Okay. So what we want to do is we want to pull a single line of these up, and they need to be the most recognizable logos. I mean, I've heard of, like, of course, the Department of Education, but I'm not a New Yorker, so I don't know a lot of these companies. But pull the most recognizable and put them in order and put that row in a carousel. This is a carousel where it's kind of automatically advancing. Put that row right below your icons and short descriptions. I like how you worded companies that insisted on Van Gogh. So pull this line up, create a row of your main 5, and then have it just cycle through the rest of these. It can cycle instead of one image at a time. It can cycle a whole row at a time. So they're seeing all these great companies that trust you, but we're delivering that up higher on the page without pushing our product in rows down too far. Okay. And that's our goal, is to make them feel good about doing business with us and then get them looking at our products. Okay. From here, we're pushing graduation, which it makes sense with the time of year it is. But what really we should be doing is now getting them into one of two funnels. Funnel A is going to be the most popular product, which I'm assuming is going to be what I would call anytime, anywhere delivery. Okay. So there's going to be a box that says anytime, anywhere delivery on the front with, you know, kind of some of the individual products on it. And then a box that says special event decoration. So if I'm here because I have an event going on, I can click on this box. If I'm here because I want to deliver a gift to a friend, I can click on this box. I want them to be flip boxes, which you have an example of here. Okay. So we've got special events. Then on the back, we're going to have corporate events, themed events, sports events, special occasions. Okay. On the box that is delivery, anytime, anywhere delivery, we're going to do the same thing, but we're going to talk about the different events that we deliver for. So birthdays, anniversaries, get well, new baby, all of these listed on the back of those two larger call to action. So I start to funnel immediately. Okay. When I click on either of these boxes, it's going to take us to a category page. You're going to have two category pages. One category page is going to be a page that just has your delivery events on it. Okay. Birthday, anniversary. So it's just basically going to look like this. The other one is going to look like this. So I click on special event decoration. I can now funnel into corporate events, themed events, etc., and start to hopefully, if you have examples of different corporate events and different themed events, you can have a few of those highlighted on that page, and then your call to action to get a quote. Okay. On the product one, same thing. But when I click on birthday, it's going to take me to our birthday, what we call a collection or category page. This is WordPress, so it's called a category page. So what are we trying to do? Well, we've established everything in the hero shot, and now we're trying to get them focused on the type of product line that they need. Okay. On our homepage, we are going to focus on delivery items as the major focus. And what we want is a product row for each of your anytime, anywhere categories, or at least your main ones. Product row is going to look like this, but you'll have one that's birthday, you'll have one that's anniversary, one that's get well, and so forth. In between two product rows, so we're going to go, let's say birthday and anniversary are the two main reasons, right? So we're going to see birthday, we're going to see anniversary, then we're going to create a large call to action row that looks like this. Let's see if there's another one, maybe more like this. Okay. It's a big full width, strong call out for events. Okay. In this row, I would put bullet types of the type of events you cover, some images of those events, and a headline example that says something like New York City's leading special event balloon decorating company. So I've seen product row. Now I'm reminded that you do events as well. Okay. So that we're still trying to sort them into our different categories. From there, a couple more product rows for different events. Remember, our homepage is about showcasing our balloon arrangements, not everything else. Okay. After the product rows, I'd like you to introduce your testimonial row. And we're doing a bit too much with the number of testimonials that we have. The number of rows that we have on the homepage. Something like this is really nice. Again, good topography, looks good. Just three or four is good. And then you can click to more and a testimonial page. If these are actual customers, I actually like this one better because there's the visual. So I would pull this row up below your fourth product row because now we want our customers to tell them how great we are. And remember, this is social proof, which is ultra important. Okay. Let's get to our introducing ourselves, which is our About Devorah, which this is good, but it's a lot of content. People like to know who's going to be doing the decorating, but for the homepage, I would be doing my image, which is a great image. Hey, I'm Devorah Lee. I think that's how you say that. Founder and lead creative at Balloon Van Gogh. Move that over on this side, maybe one paragraph in your image here, and then a learn more that takes them to a page that lets them deep dive in. There's something you've got to be aware of and concerned about, and that's called scroll fatigue, which basically means the more we ask them to scroll down, the less attention they're paying and the faster they go. So we can't have a page that's this long. It's exhausting to them. And they'll never make it to your call to action. Okay. We then have our 10% off coupon row, which is correct as is. You've got your social media integrated down here, which is good for social proof. We've got our delivery areas row, which is important. And then I want a final call to action. The rest of this is noise. It has to be this. Should be delivered by your team when you're providing a quote. You can send them to a page where they can play with this. But if we make the, if we try to tell them every little thing about us and every little option and every little thing on the homepage, it becomes so overwhelming that they get confused, they get frustrated, they get overwhelmed, and they go to look to somebody who's made it simpler. Okay. I know we're trying to be thorough in our explanation of what we do, but we can overdo it. Okay. So I would recommend simplifying. Now, the next thing in the document, I'm saying overall category pages, which don't exist. Remember that is meant, you see how long this thing scrolls? It's also hurting your load times, which we'll talk about. That's when they either click on shop delivery or events. Okay. When I click on this, it's going to take them to a page that has these images on it. When I click on shop, it's going to take them to a page that has these images on it. Okay. That way I click shop. I know I'm shopping for a birthday. I know exactly where to go. I know I'm shopping for get well. I know exactly where to go and I don't have to sift through a bunch. Right now you have them going to a page that shows little rows of each one. I should have clicked the actual button. How did I get to that page now? I'm confused. Anyway, you have a page that says birthday and the rows are sliding. Then weddings and events and the rows are sliding. I'm not quite sure how I stumbled upon that now. But we want a page that is all birthday, a page that's only anniversary and et cetera, okay? Which, oh, here it is. Let me just copy this over. Make sure I'm doing a good job explaining each of these things. This is the page I was talking about where we got birthdays. Then we got engagements and they're all sliding at the same time, almost get you a little motion sick. We shouldn't have birthdays and then view all. We should just have a page of only birthday items that we, oh, that's cute, that we decorate, that we sent them to when they clicked birthdays back on our category page. which remember our category page is this page that just has these boxes. So I click on birthday, I go to birthday. Okay. Let's go to a collection page, which you had sent me congratulations. So let's open it. Overall, this page is pretty clear. You know, we got the six results. What we don't have is any incentives to purchase. Okay. We should always have 10%. Well, in this case, we don't have enough to do 10%. So we need to put at least one item on sale. That's for the customers that are just value-based. They don't really care between these four. They just want the best deal. Okay. If that means I bump this up to 125 to mark it down to 125, okay, do so. Okay. Then you want to mark one as either selling out quickly or limited availability. That plays on the fear of loss of opportunity. If this one's on sale, put the original price here in light gray with the slash through it, the sales price here, so they can compare that savings. And then each and every one of these should have a 5-star rating below it. The 5-star does not have to be that garish gold 5 stars. They can be a nice complimentary green or black or gray. Gray is probably more appropriate than black. But that's, again, another form of social proof that we need to take advantage of. Okay. Going into your product page. Wait for that to open. Overall, the page is pretty solid. We've got our images are great. Our titles in the right place. Remember, if this is on sale, the original price should be light gray with a slash through it, sales price in black. Put your 5 stars under here. Where we get non-traditional is here with these buttons, which I wouldn't have an issue with if the page was performing faster. And then for some reason, we've got 3 columns. We've got our image column, we got our short description, and then we got our checkout details. That's forcing our column to be smaller. What really should be happening is it should say, congrats, grad, $150, our short description, and then our add to cart button below. So all of this should be down here to take advantage of the way people are used to shopping. I think we've done this to pull up all of these options, which if that's the case, I'm okay with it. However, above the add to cart button, I want to see you add your credibility builders, which remember, those are the ones we used on the hero shot. And they are the ones that's like New York City's most trusted, deliver anytime, anywhere. We don't want to really do the other two on this one because it's a product. So just pull in New York City's most trusted and deliver anytime, anywhere, and then put the credit card types you accept down below. So that's going to be the little Visa, MasterCard, American Express, Discover, PayPal, if you do, those little icons. Go right below here. Remember, black and white is our design elements, not call to action buttons. So this should be either a burnt orange, a blue, some color that people are used to clicking in order to make the purchase. Okay. Just making sure I covered everything. And I did. All right. To the next page, which is your cart. In the document, you're going to notice that I included a graph of the most common reasons why people abandon a shopping cart. Okay. Cart abandonment rates generally run about 70% in e-commerce, and there are specific reasons why people bail. This content is done by a research company. And this was, I think, last year. Okay. So if we go into our cart, here's our page that's showing us what we're buying, which is all clean and good. We then are committing two of the biggest problems that you see as reasons for shopping cart abandonment. You're going to see that the number two reason people leave without purchasing is the site wanted me to create an account. You're forcing them to create an account as far as they're seeing. Now, there is a little skip login, but this login should be an option up here that's login for current customers. This should take them straight to billing information. A lot of your customers are going to feel like they have to create an account to purchase from you, and that's going to scare them away. So do away with this step. The next problem is that we are using a multi-step checkout when it should be a single-step page checkout. A multi-step checkout is what you're seeing here, where there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 steps before you're asking them to put in their payment. Goodness gracious. It's estimated between 10 and 20% of the people who abandon your cart do so because of a multi-step checkout. Normally, they're 4 steps. We've got 5, and we're requiring login. So we're committing 2 of the biggest fouls in getting people to buy from us in the way this is done. So we need to move to a single page checkout, which basically asks for billing details, delivery, which is usually confirming that the billing is the same as delivery. If not, then it opens up a little section for them to put in delivery, and then their payment all in one page. So when they click a button, it is sending them, or they're making the purchase. They're not bouncing from page to page to page. The other thing, I don't know if you have abandoned cart software on here or not. So I'm just going to tell you about it because it's important. I'm going to tell you about the kind you need to use. Abandoned cart software, basically, if you've started to fill out this process and leave for some reason, it's going to send you an email saying, hey, did you forget something? Here's an extra discount for if you come back and finish your purchase. Okay. Well, the problem with that is it's sending an email, and emails are largely ignored. We basically relegated emails to being either business related or spam. The way people communicate now is through text. So I gave you a link to one of the texting abandoned cart softwares out there. So take a look at that. But basically, instead of an email, it sends them a text saying, hey, did you forget something? All right. So that will help your checkouts. It'll increase your conversions on its own, along with nothing else. All of this together is going to help your customers better understand where to go to shop for the content they want. It's going to put your product in front of them. It's going to utilize trust-building techniques to make them feel comfortable buying from you, etc. Okay. The next thing I did is I went and ran a speed performance test because speed is so important to how people or their willingness to work with us. On the main site, we got an F. And then I said, okay, well, how are we doing on our cart? We also got an F. So this is once we get into your shopping cart. They didn't have a New York option, so I kind of went as close as I could. And there's a couple problems. Like on the shopping cart, we got server speed problems. There's not image problems, but our server, when somebody clicks on add to cart or to move to the next steps, it's taking 1.5 seconds to even start processing that request. So a second and a half before it even before your server, that's your hosting company, even tries to do its job. Here on your main page, we've got very large images that are making it slow. Your server response time is not as big a deal. Let me show you what this is like for your visitors, okay? This is a video I've recorded of your visitor experience. This is your second count right here. So kind of watch the seconds and how the load goes. There's 1 second, there's 2 seconds, there's 3 seconds, there's 4 seconds. We're up 5 to 6 seconds before your content's even being delivered. Now, at this stage, I often have people say, Dave, this isn't true. I go to my website all the time and it doesn't take that long. To which I'll say, you're right. On your device, it won't, because you've been there before. Okay. The way the internet works is utilizing a technology called caching, which the easiest way to understand it is to understand that when you tell someone to go to your website, well, it's fundamentally wrong. They never go to your website. They download a copy of your website onto their device. Then the next time that you go to the site, it doesn't automatically download it again. The first thing it does is it checks the file to see if there's been any updates. If there has, it just downloads those updates. If there hasn't, it simply loads the files it's already downloaded. So that's why sites like GT Metrics and Google's PageSpeed Insights exist, is to help you see what your new customers are experiencing. Slow load times is the number one reason for bounce rate, which is bounce rate is the number one reason people don't interact with your web page. Also, I put a link to a document that'll help you understand Google's stance on speed in the document. I should say to an article, a link to an article. But it all comes back to this has to be fixed. You'll never be successful like this. This has to be fixed. This is the cart response time. It's taking so long to go from page to page within your cart. Your fully loaded time of your cart's 9.9 seconds. It's never going to fly. It's never going to work right. Okay. These are largely items that DIY, it just can't be done yourself unless you're extremely technical and knowledgeable. You need to hire page speed optimization specialists. Now, at this stage, I often have people reach out to me and say, Dave, I like the ideas. Can you just implement them for me? To which I wish I could say yes. And for years I could have. However, as I mentioned early on, my strokes have taken away my ability to type, so I can't work on websites anymore. Thus, I'm doing this as a way to continue contributing my experience to the world. That being said, I had a great guy approach me some time ago, and he's taken the time to learn how to utilize or implement everything I recommend. So if you do need help, reach out to me. I'll put you in touch, and you can talk with him. One last thing I want to touch on before I let you go. And that is the need to have screen recording software added to your site. This is Microsoft's Clarity product, which is free. There's also paid versions like Hotjar, Crazy Egg, Lucky Orange. But basically what they do is they let you watch how your customers are interacting with your page the way you've been watching this video. You can see where they pause. You can see what they scroll past. You can see what they click on. Where Google Analytics is giving you the 30,000 foot view saying, here's how much time they spent on your site, etc. This shows you what they're doing. I highly recommend you put a version on. Okay. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. Just reach out to me through Fiverr. That's how they ask us to communicate, and I like to honor that request. Also, thank you so much for your patience. The last couple days have been a roller coaster, to say the least. As a thank you, I'd like to offer to do a quick re-review of your website once you've implemented whichever of these changes I'm recommended in, and I'll help make sure that they've been executed properly. One heartfelt thought I want to give you is I think you've got a huge opportunity here, but I don't think your designer is executing it quite up to the standards that you should require. So you may consider changing. I hate making that recommendation, but a lot of these styles, the drop shadows, the rounded edges, these whooshes, all of these things are very dated, and it's making the website feel like you're not taking care of it as far as keeping it updated, which hurts credibility. I don't like to say it, but I'm paid to by you to tell you what to do to maximize your revenues. That should be a consideration. All right. Let me know if you have any questions. I'll be standing by. Thank you.